Live from Emerson College in beautiful downtown Boston, this is the Jeff Santos Show. Rebuilding America, together, investing, activism, and supporting the middle class. Now,
the progressive populist voice of politics.
Here's Jeff.
Good afternoon, Americans, and welcome to the Jeff Santos Show. We are live in Studio A on the campus of Emerson College. It is great to be with you on this 12th of July, 2016. We got a great show for you today. I was up in New Hampshire for the Bernie Hillary rally. The endorsement of Senator Sanders for Hillary Clinton today. A lot of Bernie supporters there. We spoke to a few of them, and we'll play some audio and video that we had of them coming up a little bit later. We'll talk with Mark Taylor-Canfield, of course, joins us from the West Coast, where there's a ton of Bernie supporters. A lot of Bernie supporters in New Hampshire today, not very happy with the senator from Vermont endorsing Secretary Clinton. A few people walked out during the actual time when Senator Sanders said, I will endorse Hillary Clinton. And it's going to be interesting to see how that works. My hope, and I think it's important here, is to see the issues that Bernie Sanders has talked about, single-payer health care, the focus on 4 years of free university. Those things get put into law. Now, here's the rub. I don't think that Hillary Clinton can do it. In other words, in order to get her to get a number of progressives elected, she's going to have to run hard and run hard. And the only way that she's going to do that is she's going to have either Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren on the ticket. I don't know if either one of them are going to make it. I don't think that her and Bernie have the best chemistry, and I don't think that they want two women on the ticket, the Clinton people. So that is the problem. And even Sherrod Brown, not a bad third choice, or Jeff Merkley, who I've heard something about, would be passable. But again, in order to win the House, Republicans are going to maintain the House, so that means nothing can get done. You can pass it in the Senate, but nothing's going to get through the House. We saw that in the first couple of third and fourth years of the Obama administration, when the Democrats controlled the Senate by a couple of votes, and then they eventually lost that in 2014 because they run on defense. And that, to me, is going to be the problem. But that all being said, I think that if Sanders was on the ticket, he would Hillary Clinton would generate tremendous amount of enthusiasm from the Sanders folks, who a few of them that I talked to today may stay home, may write in Bernie, may go to Jill Stein. And I haven't talked to many of these folks, but some may even go to Donald Trump. So Hillary Clinton and the Clinton campaign, if you're listening, pick Bernie Sanders. He is the best choice if you want to ensure victory and make change, not just, you know, be elected. That is the best choice for vice president. And I was surprised today that there were a somewhat congenial event. I don't think that, you know, these folks are going to be hanging out having beers tomorrow night. But I do believe that it was a sign that they could be on the same ticket. Now, if she goes in another direction, you can forget about the progressive support, and you can forget about any kind of revolution. We'll be right back. It's the Jeff Santos Show. Back in a flash.
Matt, you are you're 22.
Yes.
And a big Bernie supporter, and you have a great T-shirt here. Make America Love Again.
Yes, absolutely.
Why did you come out today?
I came out to because I felt like this could be one of the last chance I could see Bernie speak, and I wanted to see what Hillary had to say.
Do you think that Bernie is 100% behind Hillary, or where do you
think
the relationship is right now between those two?
I think he's 100% behind her just because he's came out and said, I can't let Donald Trump become president. So I think he's 100% behind her. And he said he's already said that he won't run third party. He's made that promise. So, yeah, I think he's behind her.
Shane, and good afternoon, Americans, and welcome to the Jeff Santos Show. We are live in Studio A on the campus of Emerson College. It is great to be with you here on the 12th of July, 2016. We got a great show for you today. Mark Taylor-Canfield will join us for about 40 minutes or so. We'll talk to him in about 15, 20 minutes past. We'll take your phone calls at 772-925-8206. Robert Craig will join us for the entire second hour, beginning at 5:06 Eastern Time. Of course, your emails are welcome, jeff@revolutionboston.com. Check us out on Facebook and Twitter, at Jeff Santos Show. Yours truly was up today in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, in a gorgeous New Hampshire afternoon, or morning, I should say, watching Hillary Clinton and watching Bernie Sanders do a little kumbaya. Well, not sure if it was the most authentic coming together, but I will say this, it was better than I expected. Now, there were a lot of people in the auditorium. It's a Portsmouth High School gymnasium, so maybe 3,000, 4,000 people, maybe a little bit more. But relatively, compared to Bernie crowds, which are usually 10, 15,000, a relatively small event. Now, here is my quick take. The Bernie supporters should not throw their hands up, in my view, and say, it's all over, we all need to go to our corners. You got to do a couple of things, in my view. We have to wait until Secretary Clinton makes her choices in terms of vice president. If she chooses either Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren, then I think that Democrats and Bernie supporters should be all in. If she doesn't, and she goes with a Cory Booker or a Virginia senator or someone else, I think that Democrats should look at progressives should look at alternatives, including Jill Stein was on the show last week and will be back again. And I think that it would be important to take a serious look at where we are with third parties. Now, I think this next song, is sort of something we should keep in the back of our minds, because this to me is a piece of something that we have to have in the back of our minds. The Rolling Stones, of course. I mean, if you can't get what you want, and you can keep playing it, Shane, I think that we have to get what we need. And a Sanders as VP, or a Sanders with major allies in the Senate, could be what we need. Now, here's something else. We have said this before. There is no guarantee that Secretary Clinton will make it through the first term. There is this indictment. They are looking into the foundation. This is Comey. There's a lot of things that could happen if Sanders is there in the seat waiting to happen. So, where I didn't think that it would make sense for Bernie to become the VP, I do believe now, with the clouds still hovering over Secretary Clinton, that this is the best chance. And the fact that the platform is as liberal as it is, 55 now as opposed to 65 for Medicare, a tuition-free up to $125,000, I wish it was just no limit, no ceiling. But that is something. That's only Bernie Sanders and his supporters that got the platform to where it is. A lot more things, including Palestine and other things that Democrats, you know, choked on. But I would say this, folks. Let's give Secretary Clinton another week or 10 days until she picks her VP, and then see what happens. Philadelphia could be fascinating. Or it could be chaos. All right. Remember that, folks. If you can't get what you want, get what you need. We're going to take a whole bunch of calls. We have a lot of people lined up here. And we'll get to Mark Taylor-Canfield. But I want to play a couple of interviews. And we're going to start with the first interview, which was with a 22-year-old who was wearing a shirt that basically talked about we need love in America. And after what we have seen this past week with what has happened in Baton Rouge and what happened in Minneapolis or St. Paul and what has happened in Dallas, not a better T-shirt around. Now, this 22-year-old, I think his name was Brett, I believe, talked to me off air, and then we did an on-camera and on-air interview. We'll play these also in between breaks on video as well for our TV viewers in New York and those watching online on FSTV. But I tell you, it's very indicative of, I think, where people are who are Bernie supporters. And I know a lot of you who are online and on hold are similar in that regard. All right, let's play the first one. Shane and Gio, this is the individual with the sunglasses. Shane, go right ahead and play that audio. All right, again, your first name?
Matt.
You're 22?
Yes.
And big Bernie supporter, and you have a great T-shirt here. Make America love again.
Yes, absolutely.
Why did you come out today?
I came out because I felt like this could be one of the last chances I could see Bernie speak, and I wanted to see what Hillary had to say.
Do you think that Bernie is 100% behind Hillary, or where do you think the relationship is right now?
I think he's 100% behind her just because he came out and said, I can't let Donald Trump become president. So I think he's 100% behind her, and he's already said that he won't run third party. He's made that promise. So yeah, I think he's behind her.
Okay. Now that was the first individual who actually was friends with this next individual. I think his name is Brett. Let's play the second one. Mr. Shane.
How do you feel now after he endorsed Hillary today?
I mean, honestly, from the outset, if I was being realistic, I knew this day was going to come. So while I am not 100% behind Hillary, in the end, when it comes to her over Trump, I would go with her as the gentleman that the other reporter I was just speaking with. I'm more or less sold on going third party unless it tightens to like between 1 and 2%, similar to, I guess, 2000 Gore Bush.
Right.
But look how that turned out. I did vote for Gore in that one. If I had to vote my conscience again, I would have voted for Nader. And in this case, I stand 100% behind Bernie, but he's throwing his support behind Hillary.
And the second guy, again, was named Brett. Now, I want to elaborate, and then we'll go to the calls and then bring in our good friend Mark Taylor-Canfield. But I think that that's reflective of a couple of people who are from New Hampshire, who are Bernie supporters, and one is ready to go for Hillary, wants to give a chance, not excited about Tim Kaine or Cory Booker or someone else. The other person is, I think, very, very concerned that, you know, Hillary Clinton may not be the woman for her. And it's very interesting. These are, again, friends of each other, 122-137. We're going to play one more, and this is audio only, from a woman. I think her name is Julie, and she was probably the most critical of Hillary Clinton. Mr. Shane, go right ahead with the third person we interviewed.
That, but I'm giving very serious thought to supporting the Greens as well. We need a viable third party, and they're working to build one, and so I may give them my vote.
You were telling me off air about the idea that, you know, there is a real need for more parties. Expand on that if you could.
Well, you know, throughout Europe, there's multiple parties, and they all elect people to the Democratic bodies, and then they have to form coalitions.
Well, there you go. That person looking very seriously at Jill Stein or possibly creating a Bernie party by herself. All right, let's go to the phones first and talk to Pete in Plant City. And then we'll continue with this with Mark and take the rest of the calls, Wayne, Mark, and Rudy after that. Peter, you lead us off, my friend. I know you're a little concerned today about what happened. How you doing?
Hey, I'm doing great. I'm just going to work my ass off for Jill Stein. And I'm going to attack every Democrat who's a free trader. Because
there you go.
Over the weekend, I got a report that Hillary Clinton's platform members were all watching a girl in the second or third row, and it was a thumbs up or a thumbs down. And when it came to a trade in the Democratic platform, she went thumbs down. And all the Democrats that Hillary nominated went a thumbs down. And I really wish that Trump, though, would have been in the fourth row watching this fiasco happen. I mean, that is the main thing. It is rigged. I don't blame Bernie. He's going to be the chairman of the Budget Committee in the Senate. He had to, you know, it was either that or, you know, the hemp leaf or whatever the poison you got to take. He did it. But as far as the Democrats, I mean, I guarantee you know, Bernie's, you know, the whole establishment was against them the whole time.
Yep.
Think about
no
it.
Doubt.
All those House members, they don't represent any working people anymore. That trade platform proved it. It just basically said, we don't give a damn about working middle class. Now, Trump is going to use that in the Big Ten states. And I hope that Jill Stein uses that so labor wakes up and starts working with the Green Party because they were screwed.
Well, we're going to try to get Jill Stein on this show for an entire hour. She's a Massachusetts resident. Going to get her here in studio in Boston. And I hope you can get through, Pete, to talk to her. Let me ask you, if Bernie somehow, and I don't know how likely this is, but if he was on the ticket with Hillary, would you reconsider?
Oh, yeah, I would reconsider, but they're not going to do that. I mean, Hillary, trust me. The
well, I would say it's Clinton, I would say it's
no,
unlikely,
no.
But I'm just asking.
Think about it. The backers of Hillary, the financial backers of Hillary Clinton, hate Bernie Sanders' guts and hate Elizabeth Warren's guts. They also know the risk that Hillary could get indicted in the future, especially with
yeah.
the House.
Yeah, well, that's
members.
The reason why. That's
sure
the reason
that.
Why.
Right.
Well, that's what I want, Warren or
right.
or Bernie as the next person in there. Yeah.
Yeah, but they would rather lose running Cory Booker. I mean,
I
they
agree.
Would rather lose
Mr. Wall Street
running another corporate. Yeah, a corporate-owned Democrat. You know, you played that song. You can't always get what you want. Sometimes you get what you need. Just like Obama,
right.
We got a pro-TPP corporate Democrat. So Jill
yeah.
Stein.
That's not what we needed.
I mean, yeah, take care, my friend.
No, thank you, Peter. It's always great. Always great to hear from you, my man. You understand the issues of trade better than any call we've ever had, and I appreciate that. All right, let's go to the Great West Coast and get our next guest ready. He, of course, is a great freelance journalist. You can see him at Daily Kos. Read him at Daily Kos. You can hear him here every Tuesday on the Jeff Santos Show. He is a fantastic journalist. We need more like him, investigating a number of issues all across this country, Reporters Without Borders and a whole slew of issues. Our good friend Mark Taylor-Canfield joins us on the line from the great state of Washington, from the great city of Seattle. Mr. Mark Taylor-Canfield joins us. Mark, how are you?
How are you, Jeff? Crazy news day, huh?
It is indeed. Yeah. It is indeed. And we will get to a very emotional speech by President Obama today on in Dallas at the memorial service for the slain officers. But we're going to stick with this issue, and we got a lot of callers to get, Mark. But I want to get your overall impression of the news emanating out of New Hampshire today with Bernie Sanders endorsing Ms. Clinton. And I wonder if you can, you know, give me your thoughts and somehow connect it to some of the people that you've been talking to over the last few weeks who are big Bernie supporters, those who are Bernie or Bust or Bernie supporters that really want no part of Hillary Clinton. What do you make of today's announcement, and how do you think people in Seattle will react to it?
Well, honestly, Jeff, I have gotten some comments from people in both Seattle in Washington State and Northern Oregon, and I cannot really repeat some of the comments that I did because these are FCC-regulated airwaves.
Yes, indeed. Yes, I have a couple of those myself.
Yes, so I have heard some comments and some expressions and some expletives, but let me start by saying that it just seems like the Democrats are sort of just playing it by ear now, right? I mean, let's not worry about counting the votes. Let's not worry about the official nomination process for the Democratic Party nomination in Philadelphia. Let's just apparently call all that off and make it up as we go along. And so that's one of the impressions that people have gotten here. It's really an unpredictable election, and I can't understand, you know, what my colleagues are thinking in the media right now, because everybody is kind of shuffling for a position. But I think that we're going to have to hear some venting first before people start having reasonable conversations about what's going on. So you may hear some of that kind of editorializing coming from me today, but there was a reasonable expectation that Bernie Sanders would wait until at least the official nominating process at the convention before he made this endorsement. And that, I'm speaking for folks who are Bernie Sanders delegates and Bernie Sanders supporters, who are obviously on their way to Philadelphia and are now not sure what they're going to do. We had a press briefing earlier today for Democracy Watch News, and there was a journalist saying, okay, I guess all of these people that are planning to go to Philadelphia that have bought plane tickets and rented cars or whatever, who are Bernie Sanders supporters, they may feel like there's no reason to go to Philadelphia now. But there is another interpretation or analysis of this, which I've been playing with, which is that there was a chance for this pro-democracy movement in the United States to be an electoral movement, but this decision by Bernie Sanders to endorse early may actually turn some of that into more of a protest movement, because there are a lot of people in the Seattle area who are not happy today, and I've heard a lot of talk about where to go from here, but I think mainly, like I said, people just need to vent right now. And I heard the rumors, you know, ahead of time, but I was skeptical, Jeff, so I really didn't think that he would endorse so early. And
yeah,
at this point,
well, go ahead.
I was just going to say there are three main reactions that I'm getting in Seattle, in this area, from Bernie Sanders supporters, and that is, number one, shock, number two, amazement, and number three, some disgust. And there actually has been, you know, the word sellout has been on the lips, at least a question has been on the lips of some of those folks. But I think since this is the most unpredictable election I've ever covered, you really can't predict what's going to happen next. And all I can say to them is that I hope that he was able to get some major concessions from Hillary Clinton, because Maybe, you know, one of the things I tweeted today was maybe they already made a deal on the VP position, you know. Something might be...
Well, that's the thing I want to... Yeah, I want to get your thoughts on this, Mark, because to me, as I was saying earlier, if he is chosen as the vice president, I think a lot of people who are very, very much now willing to look at Ms. Stein or writing in Bernie, as you heard with one of the people I interviewed after the event, I think that they would come back. Maybe not all of them, our good friend Peter included, but I think that there are that would be the best way. Now, if Hillary Clinton chooses either Bernie or Elizabeth Warren, I think she can capture the progressive movement. Outside of that, including Sherrod Brown, who I thought maybe could be part of that, but I don't think if it's Tim Kaine or Cory Booker or somebody else, Castro, I think you can forget about the progressive movement. And then I think Jill Stein, who we had on the show, and I want to thank you for helping out on that, that to me, this is a opportunity, an opportunity for where the Democrats' real heart and soul is. We saw on the platform, you know, a lot of people move it, but the platform could be a piece of paper and they could throw it in the garbage the day Hillary gets elected. So I think the next 10 days are really important between now and Philadelphia and the first day of the convention, because obviously more likely we'll pick the vice president just before. If they pick somebody outside of Warren or Sanders, I think you're going to see a very, very deflated Democratic Party come next Monday in Philadelphia, or a week from Monday. And that's how I view it. I don't know how you think about that, but your thoughts, Mark.
Well, it was expressed to me by one person that it's a little, they felt like they were a Bernie Sanders delegate, at least at the county level, and they were saying, you know, it felt a little bit like dating someone who keeps saying, I'm not really with them, I'm not really with her, you know, and then all of a sudden you find out that they're engaged to be married. So it might take a little while for people to readjust. But, Jill Stein, who was on your program last week, that was an excellent and, I think, you know, historic interview. But she is very skeptical of Bernie Sanders' endorsement of Hillary Clinton. So she's not really buying it. And so I've been checking out some of her tweets today and also Donald Trump's tweets about all of this. And yes. I think, you know, if he doesn't get major concessions,
Occupy,
from Hillary
like endorsing Goldman Sachs is a pretty good quote, actually, you know, given that.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, I'm sure he's going to play on this whole betrayal idea, but, you know, I'm just hoping that Bernie Sanders can get some concessions from the Clinton campaign, because if he doesn't, then dropping out this early might seem, you know, like a sort of an exercise in futility for folks, and I'm worried that a lot of the people who have supported Bernie Sanders who've never been involved with politics before may be really turned off completely to the electoral system and just decide never to get involved again. And that would be really, really sad. So they need to make a special effort, okay? The Democratic Party really needs to make a special effort to reach out to Bernie Sanders supporters right now. They're feeling alienated. They feel like the process was rigged from the beginning. And they are a major part of this potential victory for the Democrats, if they want it. You know what I mean? There are so many people out there. And then I have to repeat this again, and this is more direct to your question, is that 43% of the country considers themselves independents. If the candidate, a third party or independent candidate,
yeah,
were able to get all of the disaffected voters from the Democrats who won't vote for Hillary and all the disaffected voters from the Republicans who won't vote for Trump, they could win the White House.
That's the interesting, fascinating part about it. We'll be right back with Mark Taylor-Canfield on Skype after this.
Some of you, I don't know if you watched, I gave a speech last Thursday. We live streamed the speech. And one of the things that I asked of people is I said, look, we need to have good people participating in politics at every level, from the school board on up. We had no idea how many people would respond to that call. And it went out, we said, please get back to BernieSanders.com/win, W-Y-N. You know what? 20,000 people in the last week responded. That's right. And these were, I think, mostly people who were prepared to run for office, and others who said, well, I don't want to run, but I want to help people in my community run for office. So let's talk about that one for a moment. And let me start off with a confession. I ran for mayor of the city of Burlington, Vermont in 1981. If I had known how little I knew about municipal government, I never would have run. But I was arrogant and cocky, and I ran. And I won by 10 votes. And I had a very steep learning curve, let me tell you. All right, but here is the point. And by the way, my experience in municipal government before that is I went to one city council meeting, and I fell asleep at the meeting. It was the most boring meeting I ever saw in my life. Sure, I fell asleep. That was my whole experience in city government. But I was too dumb to know any better, and I actually ran for office. So my point is I have talked to people. You know, I've talked to a lot of people. People say, well, yes, it's true. I have a PhD in education. I've read 18,000 books. I don't think I'm prepared to serve on the school board. I don't know enough. We got to get over that. You got to get over that. All right? You know, nobody knows everything. Trust me. I'm a United States Senator. I can confirm that. Nobody knows everything. Many of my colleagues know a lot less than you would think. But, all right. But here's the point. You can learn, and there are a lot of other great people there to help you. You can't be intimidated. One of the things the system does in so many ways.
In the end, when it comes to her over Trump, I would go with her. The gentleman, the other reporter I was just speaking with, I'm more or less sold on going third party unless it tightens to like between 1-2%, similar to, I guess, 2000 Gore Bush.
Right.
But look how that turned out. I did vote for Gore in that one.
772-925-8206, the phone number to join us. We're talking with Mark Taylor-Canfield, independent journalist. You can read him in Daily Kos, hear him here on the Jeff Santos Show every Tuesday here on the program. And taking your calls, and we'll get to Wayne in a second. One little thing that Mark and I were talking about in regards to why this move was made before Philadelphia with Bernie endorsing Hillary. My feeling here is that he would have been shut out. Now, maybe he could have taken this and he would have got what he needed, to quote the Rolling Stones, if he would have really went public with this. But my guess is that a lot of the things that were accomplished in the platform would have been lost if there wasn't an endorsement before the next week. Now, don't forget, Hillary Clinton was at her low ebb last week with the whole issue of Comey. So my guess is that they use that as leverage because they know that things are going downhill, not up. And don't forget, next week, Trump gets the entire bump because of the convention in Cleveland. So that's why I think that this deal was a deal. Now, you can blame Bernie for taking the deal, but again, I think we need to know what the next 7 days are. If the next 7 days don't produce a vice president named Elizabeth Warren or Bernie Sanders, then Bernie fans can go elsewhere. But let's find out where Wayne's going to go. He's next with Mark Taylor-Canfield here on the Jeff Santos Show. How you doing, Wayne?
Hey, how you doing? And hello. Yes, also.
Hey, go right ahead, Wayne. That's Mark. Yeah. Yep, go right ahead, Mark.
Yes,
go ahead, Wayne. Sorry. Yeah.
Yes, I'm headed to the place where your first caller's headed, Jill Stein.
Okay.
And on Hillary's platform, there is no room for a single payer. And it's not even on the platform. And also, she says that she's not in favor of TPP in its present form. Those are her words. If you go to tradewatch.org, Lori Wallach, there's nothing good about TPP, period. So Bernie gave her his endorsement too soon. The reason why we don't even have a public option is because the word came down from the White House, President Obama. He never intended for a single payer. Hillary Clinton's doing the same thing. She's going to be ready to endorse this TPP thing. Me, I'm going to work for Jill Stein, just like your first caller. I refuse to be bamboozled. Bernie doesn't even have any leverage now because he's endorsed her. And why would he even endorse her with the platform that she's bringing into the convention in the first place? So I think that he's folded right at the end, and it's no good with me. I'm going with Jill Stein. I think she's the best candidate anyway. Since Hillary's won the Democratic nomination, I feel that Jill Stein is the best choice for president.
That's fascinating, Wayne. But in fairness to both Bernie's efforts in the platform and Hillary looking at the fact that she would reduce the health care on Medicare to 55 is a big movement. It's not single payer. I agree with you. And that's what we really need in this country. But if that is real, again, the whole question here is what is real with Hillary Clinton? You know, there is no history of her fighting for major issues, particularly economic issues. And that's the worry. Now, the thing to me is that if she buckles against, and doesn't choose Bernie as VP or Elizabeth Warren, then we know that she's back up to the bamboozle stuff. You know, says one thing in New Hampshire and does another thing in Philadelphia. That's where I think Democrats and progressives are. And I think we're going to be very interested to see how that moves in the next 10 days, because I think a lot of people will be joining you and Peter to vote for Jill Stein if it's not Warren or Bernie Sanders as the VP. Would either one of those, Wayne, move you over?
No, because once Hillary becomes president, she's going to follow what the corporations want her to do anyway, just like Obama did. I would not be bamboozled.
She doesn't
matter who the vice president is. She's going to follow the corporate line.
Mark, you hear what Wayne is saying. Is that similar to what you've been hearing today in Seattle?
Yes, there's this impression, what I call this slippery obfuscation that has come from the Clinton campaign on some of these issues, so people aren't really sure if they can trust where she stands. She tends to piece her words and make vague statements about some of this stuff. So, Wayne, thank you so much. You're right on that. I think really we're talking about a potential if. First of all, I have to admit this. I mean, the vice president as a political position is not necessarily the most powerful place to be.
I agree with you.
I think it might help in the on the platform. That might be what he's thinking. But in reality, there is this possibility that there is such a large movement now of disaffected voters that it could become sort of a new pro-democracy movement. And I don't know. I'm not predicting this, but I did ask the question in one of my posts, is Jill Stein the new Bernie? Because somebody needs to represent all of these disaffected voters. Now, I'm willing to wait to see what happens at the Democratic National Convention. I'm not advising, I'm editorializing here. I warned you earlier. I'm not advising, people to do any particular thing or support any particular party, but I am trying to observe this political scene, and it's shifting very quickly, and I think, once again, a lot of the corporate media and a lot of the high-paid political pundits who were very surprised and taken off guard by the Bernie Sanders campaign also might be in a sort of state of denial about where the disaffected voters are going to go. There's a big movement, and we've seen what happened with the Occupy Wall Street movement. We've seen what happens with the Black Lives Matter movement. There is a real sense of mistrust in the system in the United States right now, and if the Democratic Party can't reach out to those people, they're going to need to go somewhere if they're going to be in an electoral movement. If a candidate can't step up to represent them or they don't find someone who can, then all that they're left with is a protest movement, which means more people in the streets, more confrontations with police, more potential suppression by the corporate folks of independent and alternative media. So we really need to keep our heads on straight and see what happens next. The country is at a big turning point, And I'm not, as I know, no one listening to this program is happy with the violence that's been taking place lately. And we really need to seek peaceful means of resolution for all of this.
Right. Let me ask you this, guys. The thing that I think that's important here is that if it's Elizabeth Warren or Bernie Sanders' VP, I can tell you right now that the Republican Party is not going to give up on the idea of indictment or the idea of impeachment. They did it to her husband. They would have done it to Obama just in the simple fact that he had a bad passport. I don't see any reason at all to think that the idea of Hillary Clinton not serving for a full 4 years if she wins the presidency, and that's not even a guarantee. The fact is that I would rather have a Warren or a Bernie Sanders as the person number two, because then either one of them will still be in the Senate, still be able to maneuver on the Senate floor. But if you have somebody like Cory Booker in the Senate and in the VP slot, then we have no chance. You know, I mean, we're sold out to Wall Street for the next 8 years or 4 years. And then they get a Republican, so it'll be forever, basically. So that's why I think it's important for either one of them to be on there. Wayne, I appreciate the call, my friend. Thank you. Let's continue to go to the phones. Rudy, you're next on the Jeff Santos Show, and I'll get your thoughts on that, too, Mark. Rudy, you're next. How you doing, Rude?
Okay. I heard some of Bernie's words this morning on some clips, and I never heard more hopeful words than he expressed. And he's the closest thing we've had to a co-president at the present time than ever before, except for President Cheney and Vice President Bush. Now, the thing is that those people in the Hillary camp who had the thumbs down on the platform, they can be moved out. You've got an outsider who has now become an insider. And this insider has got a whole new different message for the people. And if people like that message, they'll continue to follow it. I don't think Bernie supporters should lose faith with him. The experience he had, he knew he had to make the move he made. And if you want to keep the progressive movement rolling along, keep supporting Bernie, because you'll see him do great things in whatever position he is in. And, you know, it's if you saw the movie Patton, and they wanted to know when Rama was out of Egypt, why they won, because they had this new general. But they said it was Rama's plan that won. Same thing here. It's Bernie's plan that's been put out there. She has signed on to it. If she backtracked, there's not been public relations. And if Bernie was vice president, I think he would become president eventually, because she's done some very risky things. And who knows what other things might be wrong in that situation as far as her health condition, this, that, and the other. So
I agree with you, Rudy. So you're in favor of Bernie being VP or Warren? Would that be a correct assessment from your perspective, Rudy?
Yeah, I would. I would. I didn't think so a while ago, but I'm rethinking it. And because of the risky nature of Clinton, I think she's going to, she could very well stumble in this next 4 years.
I agree. And the Republicans, that's all they know how to do is impeach or force somebody, you know, not to get their agenda done. They did it with Obama and, of course, the last few years with the whole Monica thing with Bill Clinton. So, you know, that's the way I see it. I mean, the reality is that you're not going to, unless Bernie and or Elizabeth is on the ticket, you're not going to be able to win the House back. So that means it's a guarantee that the Republicans will win the House. That means nothing is going to get done, because nothing will get through Paul Ryan and the Democrats. Now, there may be a couple of things. There'll be some infrastructure bill and some other things. But nothing's going to get done, just like the last few years. That's what I've been saying. Hillary basically brings us what we are right now, status quo. That's what we get.
Bernie,
picks Bernie.
Bernie
he
has,
picks Warren.
Yeah,
then we have something real.
Bernie has won 22 states. There is no other contender on our side that's got that kind of a background. They're going to do a parachute into this election with nothing behind them? Bernie's got 22 states behind them.
Yeah.
Don't rock the boat. Stay with Bernie.
Mark, let me. What do you think about that? And there probably are some people that I would agree with Rudy, and I'm probably one of them, that this is the case. Now, again, they don't pick Bernie. They don't pick Elizabeth Warren. All bets are off. And, again, say hello to Jill Stein. Mark, your thoughts.
Well, first of all, it's very ironic that the Republican Party's the party and the Democratic Party leadership especially are trying to quell all of this enthusiasm that's entered their parties, all of this energy and all these voters. Now, on the part of the Republicans, there's a good reason for that. That's a reasonable position. On the part of the Democrats, it's not such a reasonable position because, as we said before, this is the year of the underdog and the independent. I'm worried that the Democratic Party may defuse this Bernie Sanders revolution within their own party, and that there will be a lot of folks who will then feel alienated from the Democratic Party. That's what they need to avoid, I think. And also, they need to avoid that because then they're going to become a very unenthusiastic, middle-of-the-road status quo party, as you said, and they're not going to attract much enthusiasm or energy in the coming election. So it's just ironic to me that the suppression of this new energy is what both parties seem to be concerned about instead of embracing it. And second of all, if there is a political revolution within the Democratic Party because of Bernie Sanders and his delegates and supporters, then that would be a great thing for the party, that would be a great thing for the country, and could actually be the determinant element in the election of a Democratic candidate. If that doesn't happen, then once again, we're left with a lot of disaffected voters who, at this point, don't feel like the electoral system gives them anywhere to go. And then all bets are off. I really don't know. I mean, it's either – I look at it this way, Jeff. The way things are going, there probably will be some kind of political revolution, peaceful, hopefully, and that it'll either happen within the political system or outside of it. I mean, that's what happened during the Occupy Wall Street movement. That's what happened during the protest against the World Trade Organization. If you don't give people a platform and an electoral system where they can be represented and feel like they have a voice, then they feel that there's no place to go but to the streets. And oftentimes that is not all that effective either, but it's an act of frustration on a lot of folks who just feel like they can't find a place to get a voice in the system. That's also why alternative media and programs like yours are so important, because that's also true in the corporate media, that people feel not only that they don't have voices in the Democratic and Republican Party or in their own labor unions in a lot of parts of the country, but they also feel like there's no voice reflecting them or representing them in the corporate media. So it's really important that we get independent voices out there to speak the truth. And I have to admit that listening to Jill Stein's interview on your program and just in general having interviewed her, she seems to be just speaking straightforward. You know, she's telling the truth as she sees it. I don't see anybody controlling her as a puppet. She is speaking from her heart, and that's very rare. That's also what we got from Bernie Sanders. So I think that's why also some folks are a little bit disappointed that he's now endorsed Hillary Clinton. Because a lot of people who support Bernie Sanders in the Northwest have never supported Hillary Clinton. So this is sort of now they have a new decision to make, right? They weren't discussing this possibility even, you know, 2 weeks ago. Everyone just assumed that we would find out during the convention, during that official nomination process, well, where this was going to go. And there was even some talk of contesting the election and contesting some of the votes, the caucuses and primaries. And apparently that is not going to happen. However, they won't be able to avoid major protests. There will be people in the streets in Philadelphia.
That's for sure. There will be major protests. And I think the fact that Comey came out and said that there is no indictment, I think also changed the game plan for Bernie Sanders, because if there was an indictment, he would never have endorsed, in my view, and you would have seen a whole different kind of convention. But with that news of no indictment, and then followed with all this real sadness of the issue, which took the whole indictment off the front pages, what happened in Baton Rouge, what happened in St. Paul, and what happened in Dallas, you know, the news has been dominated, and off goes the Hillary concern. So I think that also helped what happened today. And, you know, this news was leaked in the last few days. That was the case. Rudy, thank you for the call. Let's go one more call here before we lose Mark. Thank you, Rudy. Let's go to Mark in San Francisco. You are next on the Jeff Santos Show with Mark Taylor-Canfield. How you doing, Mark?
I'm doing well. Hi, Mark. How you doing?
Good, Mark. I think we need nicknames or something so we can tell which Mark we're referring to.
Mark from San Francisco. What's your reaction, Mark from San Francisco, on the endorsement today of Sanders and Clinton? What does it mean to you, and how are you looking at these next few days and the choice of the vice president to make your determination on what kind of support you're going to give Hillary?
Well, I want Elizabeth Warren or Bernie Sanders as the VP pick. But I think
if you don't get it, what happens?
It's back to the issue that I'm concerned about the most, and I think that's why Bernie endorsed Hillary, and that is the Supreme Court. If we want to get money out of politics, we better have a Supreme Court. If we get a right-wing Supreme Court, you saw what happened with them picking Bush. You saw what they did with Citizens United. If you want a progressive movement, you better get a good Supreme Court, because if you don't, you could have the progressive movement you want, but you're going to be out in the streets fighting. You're not going to be able to do it politically or peacefully.
But let me ask you this, Mark, because this is the concern that I have. Let's just say that no one retires, or maybe it's just one in the case of the Scalia seat. What happens if in 2019 the Republicans, and that's probably the case, will control the Senate? Are they going to give Hillary Clinton the choice that she wants? So, therefore, it's an unknown who we get on the Supreme Court. Anyways, just something to think about.
I understand that, but I think you have to look at first things first. You want to be able to pick the Supreme Court with the president. After that, you know, there is concern, but I'm telling you, a right-wing Supreme Court has done so much damage to this country. If you can't see what they've done, and seen the threat of more of it, to me, that's the big issue. And I think Bernie sees that.
Would you at all consider Jill Stein? What would make you vote for her? Anything?
Not with the Supreme Court in the balance. I mean, I respect the other callers and their views, and I respect the fact that they don't want to vote for Hillary because they just feel it would be an injustice to their way of thinking about a candidate. But to me, like I said, the Supreme Court's my big issue. We lose the Supreme Court to the right wing, we're in deep trouble for years. That's how I see it.
Mark, this is, it's been interesting that we have had four different callers here, and all have very different perspectives. I don't know if you got a chance to hear Peter, who wants no part of it, is going to go work for Jill Stein, period. But and Wayne, to a lesser extent, similar situations. Both Rudy and Mark seem to be, leaning toward Hillary, but only if Bernie is there. If Kim Kaine is picked, or Cory Booker, what kind of hesitancy does that give you, Mark?
I just imagine
Mark in San Francisco.
Believe me, that would sicken me, to be honest. And then I'd have to really, really think about my choice. But, I hope that doesn't happen. That's all I can say. I really do.
Yeah. No, I appreciate that, Mark from San Francisco. Mark from Seattle, Mark Taylor-Canfield. What are your thoughts here? We've had some different perspectives here. We got a couple of minutes. Your analysis of what we've heard here.
It's this problem of feeling like we are held hostage by these two parties, which have control over, let's face it, through their advertising budgets through the media and through the electoral system. So folks might be hesitant to think about Jill Stein because of this, stigma of the third party, because it isn't easy to get your candidate registered in all 50 states. But I really think that there is a big protest movement, and I imagine that the kind of election that you're talking about with a more middle-of-the-road VP choice. It would make it actually, I'll be honest, as a journalist, it would make it a much more boring and mundane election to cover. The Bernie Sanders campaign brought in a lot of excitement. It was a very interesting campaign to cover because of the issues that he was addressing directly. If we get a more watered-down Democratic Party platform that doesn't address these things like $15 an hour minimum wage, TPP, a lot of these other issues, then once again, for me and for a lot of voters, it's just going to seem like the same old status quo candidates, and they won't see any change, and that's what people want. They want change. There are many different interpretations of what that change should be,
yeah.
But they want change.
No doubt. Gotta run, Mark. Thank you for being with us today on Skype. 45 minutes. It's great work with you, Mark. Really appreciate that. We'll talk to you next Tuesday. And we'll get some emails from both Steve in California and Elizabeth from Massachusetts in the second hour. Stay tuned. My name is Jeff Santos from New York and FSTV. Right now, I gotta go.